So you need parts for your Chevy, Ford, or Mopar? Well, guess what? The guys at National Parts Depot have those parts in stock right now. If you need a part for your classic car, they probably have it. They have four convenient locations across the United States. They have a location in Ocala, Florida, one in Charlotte, North Carolina, another in Detroit, Michigan, and one in Ventura, California. You can call these guys 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, nearly 365 days a year, and get the parts you need for your classic car. What's not to like? If you don't want to talk to a human being, they have a website available that has all the parts listed on there, and you can order them right online from anywhere in the world. Give National Parts a try. We like these guys. They've worked with us for a long, long time. Great people, great service, and you can get the parts really quick. So, you F100 guys will know immediately what you're seeing on the floor here, and this is a disc brake setup for a 1973 on up to about 79 Ford F100. And what we're gonna do is we're actually gonna put disc brakes on our 1972 F100 in our full-on effort to make it as undrivable as everything else is here at the shop. We're gonna put disc brakes on it. And we're gonna show the complete how-to on that going from today, when we're basically going to be talking about all the things that you need in order to do this, the different brake packages and all that are available, and the things you can do to the front end on an F100, all the way out to the final install of the original stock style components on our F100, which should, you know, probably consume weeks, like things usually do around here. What I've got here on the floor is basically everything. This is what I bought when I bought this from the guy I got them from. And what I got was literally all of this for $150. He didn't need it, and I wanted it real bad, so it's sitting here on our floor. If you're gonna do this, this is the way to go about it. You should try to get everything. Now, obviously, our springs here are not really gonna be necessary. We're not gonna be keeping these because their spring rate may be for a 302, it may be for a 351 Windsor, and we're running a big block 390, or AKA 360 in our F100. So these springs right here are not gonna be for our truck, so we're gonna ditch them here in just a minute. The disc brakes are a standard disc brake package for any F100. The F250 disc brakes are different. They are a four-piston caliper. They were available on the early trucks, probably starting in about 1970. Not real sure on the date on that. This was because the F250 was absolutely designed for towing capacity and being able to tow big, heavy things. So you wanted those disc brakes because they would stay cooler and all that. I'll go into that a little more in just a second. This, though, is what they came out with in 73 on up. Now, I will say that, you know, the rotor's a little bit smaller, but you're going to get the same braking capacities in a way out of this that you would out of an F250. The difference is the clamping force that's going to be available to you with a single piston caliper like these run, as opposed to the dual piston calipers that the 250 ran. Now what I'm going to do is I'm going to kind of break down what we've got here and what we're going to be using off of all of this in order to throw it over onto the 1972. All right, now what we're gonna do is I'm gonna talk a little bit about the disc brake setup on this and the different things that are available. National Parts Depot has literally everything in stock to do a stock front disc brake rebuild. There is also a new kit that they are offering through their catalog that you can get that is a complete setup that bolts basically to the stock spindles in place of the drum brakes. Problem you will run into now is finding this particular style of disc brake kit. And when you get it, like I've said before, you need to get everything from the spindles all the way out to the arms because you don't know what you may need from all this stuff. So the best way to go about it is if you find one in a salvage yard and you get that kind of lucky, grab everything from the radius arms all the way through to the I-beams, because what you can do is you can take all this stuff, use what you need to, paint it, get it ready to go, and then all you've got to do is just slide all of it back into the truck and you're good to go on that front. The disc brakes are very adequate disc brakes. I like the fact that they have the shields on here. A lot of times in your aftermarket kits, you don't get a shield on the back side of the rotor like you do on this. So it makes for a much more clean installation and one that's not going to see as much water on it as you would with an aftermarket kit, because you can get a little bit of splash on. And remember, our truck is a working, driving truck, so it's not like this thing's gonna sit around and just look pretty. All right, now I'm gonna talk real briefly about the brakes and what we have here. I feel pretty sure this is a 77 to 79 front brake kit, and the reason for that is the shields on here. The earlier shields are not pulled into the rotor as much, and they do not have this this scoop to bring cool air into the disc brakes so that it'll pull it in here and push it out through the openings in the top of the rotors. You can sometimes get lucky and have enough to have these returned a little bit. I'm feeling like these are probably pretty shot, so we're gonna go ahead and get discs from the guys at National Parts Depot to fix this. And we're gonna check everything. Our rotation on this is really still real nice. We may be in a position where these spindles themselves are not real useful, and we don't want that. That would be bad. Right now, I've taken all the components off. Basically, what I wanted to do is to make sure that I have a good spindle here. The things you want to check for is unusual wear on the bottom side of the spindle. This one feels real nice. There's a little bit of a ridge, but it's really not even a ridge that I could call. I think it's mostly just the knurling where they turn down this to the flat part of the spindle. Where the actual bearing rides is in really good shape. Our bearings on this one are actually in good shape as well, so I'm real happy about that. Back part back here, same thing. There's really no wear to speak of on here. All I feel is the ridge line from where they went in and turned this. There's a spot right here with a little bit of a raise to it. But overall, it's in really good shape. So the spindle seems to be pretty nice. Possibly even reuse these rotors. There may be enough meat on them left, but I think I'm gonna go ahead and just redo a set of rotors, because you don't know if these are even warped. They may be in bad shape from having sat up for so long. The grease is all good. I'm pretty confident that we'll be okay with that. Now what I'm going to do is I'm going to go in and check my kingpins and see if there's any lost motion in those, because if there is, we're going to have to put a set of kingpins in this, and that's going to change our line of attack a little bit, because we're going to have to go in and start working on that stuff. That'll be exciting, because Cam says it's not a big deal. He's not here because of the COVID-19 quarantine thing, so I don't know. But I do know how to go in and check the kingpins. If they are in good shape, we're just gonna grease them and reuse them. Move them over. All right, now what we're gonna do is we're gonna test our spindle to make sure that the kingpin is in good shape on this truck assembly. This is not the preferred method for doing this. Ideally, what you would want to do is you would have everything mounted on the truck, have a tire on here, pick it up, and rock it back and forth this way to see if you got any noise or a lot of movement from the kingpin. And the reason for that is the tire adds weight, because right now, if you pick this thing up and you start moving it, I'm actually just moving the kingpin and spindle assembly vertically. This way, I'm not actually doing anything as far as finding out where the lower kingpin and the upper kingpin wear points are. So I'm going to try to put vertical pressure on it and pull. I got nothing. No movement. That's a boy, that's a good sign. I know there's probably some guys out there that want to see us do a video on doing kingpins on a truck. And at some point we may do that, but for right now, we don't need to on this truck. And my daddy always told me, if it ain't broke, don't fix it. Actually kind of sound a little like Pops at that moment. In any case, that's what we're gonna do with this here. So we're gonna pull this back out so I can talk about the spindles and the I-beams in a little more detail, because there is a reason why you want to make same on this stuff. All right, now, the reason that you want to have a matched pair of I-beams and spindles is the steering stop, because there were some changes on this between the years. 73, 74 is different than 75, I believe. 77 to 79 is different yet again. So if you're going to get the disc brakes, by all means, grab the spindles as well. You can grab the radius arms if you want. You don't necessarily have to, but I find it would be a lot easier to go ahead and just grab all of this stuff at once. All right, now what I'm going to talk about is basically aligning one of these old trucks. And the problem you run into with alignment is pretty much everything is set by Ford, even the camber and the caster. You can't go in and really change camber and caster on these, as far as I can tell. There's no way to change the radius arm position to get more caster out of the front end. Ford put a pretty good bit of caster in here, so it rolls out okay for what it is. But there's no way to change camber. And what can happen with a Ford F100, especially with a stock style suspension on it, is you start wearing the outside edges of the front tire more quickly on these trucks, because it's really hard to get the camber absolutely perfect. Back in the day, guys would go in and actually bend the I-beam in order to change the camber of the tire. In other words, if a tire is rolling this way, you want to have a little less or more camber depending on what the front end was doing. They would actually go in, and there was a device that they could put on the I-beam to bend the I-beam to get more camber out of it. I don't know why. Ford should have done something about this to make that a little bit better, but it is what it is. The camber you get from the factory is the camber you're stuck with, and there's not really a good way to fix that problem. Unless you can find somebody with the old school tools that can set the camber up for you by bending the I-beam, you're just going to have to live with whatever you get for a camber setup on these trucks. All right, well, that's our episode for this week. There really isn't any more to talk about here. Am I going to go in and restore these, you know, radius arms and do anything with the I-beams? No, I'm not going to. I'm probably just going to leave everything the way it is. It's an old truck, and if you look at the undercarriage on the truck, I've made the engine bay look nice, but this thing's driven all the time, and we take it to the dump. We drive it all around the joint. We go on dirt roads with it. To go in and spend a lot of time restoring the look of this stuff is just going to be a waste of effort, in my opinion, so I'm not going to do any of that. Do me a favor though, leave a comment in the section below. Tell me what you want to see in this. I mean, I know we're going to be doing the disc brakes. We also have a sway bar and shock episode coming up on the F100 in the time that we're doing all this stuff. Because, you know, while we're here, we're going to be doing that as well. Comment in the section below. Tell me what you think. Tell me what you want to see. Give us a thumbs up or a thumbs down. Either way, it's going to make me happy to know that you're actually being involved with what we do on the show. And finally, everybody take care of yourselves. Be careful out there. It's a crazy world. You guys have a great week, and we'll see you next time on Autorestomod. All right, so we are now going to test. Light. Goodbye. It's probably a transmission fluid. Kids over here snorting transmission fluid.
Or cocaine.
There's no cocaine here.
Yeah, there is. Don't tell them though.
We don't do any coke around here, okay?
Coca-Cola.
We do Coca-Cola. We do coke. We're not doing coke, man! Are you guys ready?